I begin in the name of Allah, the Most Kind, the Most Merciful. It's due to that kindness and mercy that we have these opportunities where we gather in remembrance and glorification of Him, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. We began now into the second part of the sermon number 83 of Imam alayhi salam, known as Khutbatul Gharra, or the honorable or the beautiful sermon. And the first line of this second passage, the Imam alayhi salam says, Usikum ibadallah bitaqwallah, that I advise you, O the servants of God, to be God conscious, or to have taqwa, to be God wary. And we discussed what that means in detail yesterday. And then we said that after the Imam alayhi salam says that we should be God wary, or we should be God conscious, then the Imam alayhi salam begins to describe for us 10 sifat of Allah, 10 attributes of God, or really 10 things that God does for us, that when we reflect on them, the result of that reflection would be that it would increase our God consciousness. Yeah? Wallah, I looked at all of your eyes and I saw nobody paying attention to me. Yeah? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So let me repeat what I said, right? That in the first passage or the first line, the Imam alayhi salam said that we should be God conscious, that he advises us to increase in our taqwa. And then immediately the Imam alayhi salam mentions 10 qualities of Allah, qualities which he does for us, for our benefit, that when we reflect upon these qualities, it should increase our God consciousness. So the Imam not only tells us to be God conscious, but then gives us 10 ways in which we can increase our God consciousness when we reflect about them. So the first thing the Imam alayhi salam, then he says that we should be conscious and wary of Allah because Alladhi darabal amthal. You know, like when you look at Arabic, the word Alladhi that is used there, it normally, generally will follow a noun. And so it is a descriptive word. So Alladhi literally means the one who. So when Allah, and he says, Usikum ibadallah, that I advise you, O the ibad of Allah, to have taqwallah. And then when he says Alladhi, the Alladhi now begins to describe Allah, which is the noun that came prior. So these are 10 descriptives, if you can use that word, to describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first one he says, Alladhi darabal amthal, the one who has furnished illustrations or examples. Amthal. When we look at the Holy Quran, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in over 165 different places uses amthal or a mathal. Mathalul ladhina yunfiqu amwaluhum fi sabilillah. The parable of those who spend their wealth for the sake of Allah. Or mathalul ladhina kafaru. The parable of those who disbelieve. The entire Quran, there are over 165 different, or 169, if we can be that specific, examples where Allah has used parables. Now, why does God use parables? God uses parables to bring a matter which is unknown to us, close to our minds by using an example that we would understand. So it's like a metaphor. Like if I'm describing for you a concept that is foreign to you, I would probably use a metaphor or an example for you to understand what I'm talking about. It may not give you the full description or the full understanding, but that metaphor will allow you to at least get some form of comprehension of what I'm talking about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to us about concepts that are entirely foreign to us. He's talking about heaven. We've never seen heaven, right? He's talking about hell. We've never seen hell. He's talking about matters of faith. You can't literally touch iman. You can't literally touch kufr, right? And so the way that he begins to make, the way that he Once the methodology that he uses for us to understand what he's talking about is by giving us amthal or parables. You understand? Okay. Now, these parables serve an important function. It's important to keep in mind that these parables are not an exact duplicate of what it will be like. So for example, if we get to Jannah, inshallah, and we find that where is this rivers of milk and honey, I don't see these rivers of milk and honey, we better not put a complaint to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you had promised me date palm trees with castles and I don't see any of that. The descriptions that are given, many ulama even believe that these are simply amthal, these are parables for us to understand. You think about it, that the description of paradise as being something that is full of shade and rivers flowing would be very attractive for a group of people living in the desert, right? That you tell them that, look, you do good and there's gonna be this waiting for you. Now, if my whole life is mashallah shaded, yeah, and my whole life is alhamdulillah, all these beautiful charms, then those charms of God like don't seem like that great, right? Like I can get them in dunya, you understand? And so depending on the context or the context of those revelations are based on who it was being revealed to. But the point of God was to bring about a closeness of understanding to the concept that is going to be something that is far better and than our minds have ever imagined, for example. You understand? So the parables serve a purpose, but the parables aren't to be taken as exact. That being said, what the Imam alayhi salam is mentioning here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has furnished for us examples or parables on concepts that our minds may not generally understand. And so what Allah has done is that He has not left any stone unturned for us. There is nothing that we don't know. There is nothing that is hidden. There is no concept that hasn't been touched upon by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore He has furnished الَّذِي ضَرَبَ الْأَمْثَالِ. He has done His hujjah. Yeah? We can't come to Allah and say, but you didn't tell me about this. But you didn't tell me about that. This statement of Imam is even more true for us today, 1400 years later. Yeah? That we have more descriptions and more knowledge at our disposal to where we can understand concepts that people at one time may have needed amthal to understand or parables to understand. We always give this example, and I'm sure I've said it many times, but you look at these statements or these traditions that tell us don't leave your mustaches long, for example, because shaitan will sit on it, right? Or don't leave pots open because shaitan will sit on it. Well, at that time, the Prophet had no way, the Prophet could not describe germs to the people at that time, right? And saying that there are these microbes that exist, and then these microbes, if they get into your blood system, the people would have been like, what's happening, right? Or maybe at that time they understood what shaitan literally means. But these are parables, amthal, that are given, that are there for us to understand what the concept is. And so when the Imam alayhi salam says that Allah has furnished for us illustrations, sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, that He has furnished for us illustrations, what He's saying is that there is nothing that Allah has not taught us, that Allah has not mentioned. And therefore, when I understand that there is nothing that has been left unsaid or untaught, then it should create within me a greater sense of appreciation for what my Lord has done for me. He hasn't left me in the dark. Yeah? When Allah is telling me that, look, these are the things that I need you to do, and then if He doesn't provide me for the guidance that I'm required to do those things, then I have a complaint against God. So you see, the fact that He has furnished these examples for us should increase my God consciousness, because everything has an answer. You follow or no? Inshallah, you will when you eat something, inshallah. Yeah? But furthermore, I think this adds to a very important point here, right? That when we sin today, especially today, we are not sinning because we were ignorant about something. We are sinning because we choose to sin. You understand? Everything is known to us. This is what it means to us today. When he says that he has furnished all amthal, all illustrations, all examples, that means there is no nook or cranny that I can find a gray area that I can do something and tell Allah, look, you didn't tell me about this. Everything is sorted for us. In today's day and age, we sin because we choose to be rebellious, not because we choose to be ignorant or we are ignorant about something. And that again brings about a sense of appreciation for my Lord who has taught me everything and has shown me the way. The second example of Allah that he mentions, he says, وَوَقَّتَ لَكُمُ الْآجَالِ, and that Allah has timed for you your lives. There is no guarantee with life, right? And I think that that's something that we believe, but we don't have yaqeen about it, you know? There's a difference of iman, right? A belief in something is important, but then certainty in something is when we can see it, when we can tangibly feel it, right? When you look at the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the ghaib, right? He says, أَلَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ, those who believe in the unseen, those who believe in that which was sent to the prophets. Iman is what is asked for. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ. But when it comes to Akhirah, I want yaqeen, Allah says. I don't want iman in Akhirah. I want a higher level of certainty. Because it is only the belief that I could die at any moment and that I will be taken to account for my actions, this is the most powerful force of change there is. The most powerful force of change there is. Nothing else will work as strongly as a certainty that I'm about to die anytime. Right? This is why generally people who are given the opportunity by Allah to die in a gradual way, they have more regrets as they go, don't they? They begin to see the finality of what they have done and where they are going now. And so they want to do more istighfar. They have more regrets. They want to try to make more amends. And maybe Allah will accept from them, right? Because He gave them that chance. Maybe He will. We leave that to God to decide. But some of us will not get that chance, right? Some of us will die just like that. And we need to realize that that death can happen at any time. And so I really need to be prepared for it. And so if I'm in that mindset at all times, that look, death can come at me, death can come at me, death can come at me, then that should bring about a heightened sense of doing what God wants from me, a heightened sense of God consciousness, right? Now again, it's like what we talked about yesterday. These things are known to us, my brothers and sisters, right? Is how do I remember death all the time? You know, like if I go to a funeral, okay, I'm gonna remember death. If I look at the news, I'm gonna remember death. But man, I seem to forget about death when it's time for Fajr, you know? That man, I seem to forget about death when I get into my car and wanna listen to some music. Man, I seem to forget about death when I'm backbiting after eating iftar and it's so much fun, right? Man, I forget about death when I'm fighting with kids for food in line. You know what I mean? All of these things, like the times when I'm needed to remember death, I just seem to forget death, you know? And so we got to figure out ways. The way we gave examples yesterday, right? Like switching things, like I switched my ring, like I said, just to get in the mindset of trying to remember God more frequently. We need to learn to do things to remind us of death all the time. So we need to couple that, because those are how we get reformed, right? It's revolutionary. Death is revolutionary. And so this is something the Imam says, that if we focus on all the time, it will bring about within us more God consciousness. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ma salli ala. Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And then the Imam alayhi salam says the next thing that God has done for us is wa albasakumur riyash, and he has given you covering of dress. It's really interesting that out of all of the bounties that he could have chosen to remind us of Allah, he chose clothes. Right? He has given us clothing. And this has to do with the fact that the Holy Quran associates clothing to taqwa. Right? Allah says in the Holy Quran in Surah number 7, verse number 26, Ya Bani Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. And he says, O children of Adam, we have indeed sent down to you clothing to cover your shame, a clothing for your beauty. وَلِبَاسٌ تَقْوَى ذَلِكٌ خَيْرٌ. But the libas, or the covering of taqwa, that is even a better garment, Allah says. Right? Because it keeps us away from the fire of Jahannam. And so this clothing that we wear, which hides our faults and hides our embarrassments, taqwa does that for our sins. Right? When I remember God, I would not dare put myself in a situation that would be embarrassing for me if I were to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And so one of the things that we can practically do is that whenever we wear our clothes in the morning, remember God at that time, right? We've taken a lot of God's bounties for granted, you know? But clothing, again, if we remember that this is like, oh Allah, as I am wearing this, can you cover my faults, my spiritual faults, the way these clothes cover my physical faults? These things, you know, I've come to the point in my own growth and in my own tabligh, to be quite honest, is where these things that I'm telling you, I don't think they should be unknown to you, right? Islam hasn't changed over 1400 years. And the content is the content. It hasn't clicked in yet. And that's the shame. Yeah, it hasn't clicked in yet. Because if it had clicked in, then all of this wealth of information, we would have been like amazing believers by now. Amazing believers. You follow what I'm saying? It's like a lecture I gave here a few months ago. I mean, sudhera na thi aji. We haven't become better yet. I don't know what's holding us back. Because these things that I'm telling you, it's not the first time you're hearing these. Remember God, remember death, remember these things. But it's how to practically do it. Right? And it's not something that I can come up with. And I say like, okay, you got to do this. We got to come up with these things together. Because we cannot be satisfied with our current life. We can't be. I don't care how wealthy we are. I don't care how successful we are. I don't care what fame and fortune has brought for me. Our concern in this world is not about material gains. It has to be about ukhrawi gains. About gains of the hereafter. That's what we've been created for by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so if my life is not going towards that, I'm failing. And the sad part is, I don't even know I'm failing because I'm so admiring the things that I've done in my life, right? I'm checkboxing things and say, oh, I did this, I did that. But man, where's my checkbox to God? You know, where's my checkbox to Akhirah? And so we got to come up with really, we got to come up with more practical ways. And I'm just talking to you right now, right? That if you come up with ideas, then you got to implement them yourself. You got to implement them with your family. And if you find that that has been successful with you and your family, then you have to implement it amongst your friend circles. And then you got to implement it in a larger thing. And that's how we make change within societies, right? It starts as family structures. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Ali Muhammad. And then the Imam says, the next thing that Allah has done, wa arfa'a lakumul ma'ash, and He has expanded for you your livelihood. In the previous example, he mentions a very specific bounty, and that is the bounty of clothing. Now he mentions the general bounty of God, that how much God has done for us. And it really ties in with what I was just saying to you, that if we were to examine our lives, it is amazing how beautiful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. It's truly amazing how beautiful He is. there's no one as beautiful as him, right? There's really no one as beautiful as God. The way that he can overlook my mistakes and still be kind to me, I can't wrap my head around that, you know? We are constantly, we recite in that dua of Rajab, right? Ya man yu'ti man sa'ala wa ya man yu'ti man lam yas'alhu wa man lam ya'arifhu. That oh, the one who provides to those who ask you, but oh, the one who provide to those who don't ask you, and to those who don't even know you, you provide. Subhanallah, right? Subhanallah. And that's one angle. And so I claim to know him, right? I claim to know Allah. But then yet my actions are not consistent with me knowing God. Right? They're not consistent. Some days, mashallah, my actions are very much in line with what God wants. And then there are other days where my actions are not in line with what God wants. They're in line with what my desires want. And yet during those moments, Allah still provides for me. Amazing. I don't know. وَلَمْ أَرَ مَوْلًا كَرِيمًا أَصْبَرَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ لَئِيمٍ مِّنْكَ عَلَيَّ يَا رَبْ. Subhanallah, that's what we recite in Dua Iftitah. We say that I have not known someone as amazing and as patient as you over someone who constantly disrespects you, O Allah. Constantly disrespects you, right? Like when we enter the month of Ramadan, we are told that وَهُوَ شَهْرٌ دُعِيتُمْ فِيهِ إِلَىٰ ضِيَافَةِ اللَّهِ. It is a month in which you have been called to the banquet of God. And I was thinking about this. When I gave the lecture at Masumin, I mentioned this. Like imagine, right? Like for example, if you were rude to me, right? And trust me, I make a mental note of all of you who are rude to me, you know? But if you were rude to me, and if you were not nice to me, and it continued, when my daughter gets married, you're not getting invited to my daughter's wedding. You know what I'm saying? Like, am I wrong? No, I'm not wrong. I'm not going to invite you. Sharam na tiyani basa. This guy has no respect for me, no shame, I have treated God with lack of respect time and time again, yet I am invited to the banquet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? I just don't get it. I don't get the extent of the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? And so the Imam alayhi salam is saying that when I look at my life and I examine all of the things that God has done for me, my God, how could that not create within me a sense of appreciation for what Allah has done? A sense of longing to do something back for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? I struggle with this with our own children sometimes, right? When you do something nice for your child, and children, you know, children are the most beautiful example of what we are to God, right? And the child doesn't say thank you right away. What's your first thing? You're like, man, right? Like, I can't believe you didn't say thank you to me, right? Imagine God saying that to us every day, every day, every day. And then if my child misbehaved, I would take that away from them. Yet I misbehave and God just is more kind to me. It should bring about a connection to God. And so some takeaways that I want you to do tonight, and I will do them inshallah. Remember that when I sin, I am sinning because I choose to sin, not because the laws are not clear in Islam. Yeah, my time could run out any time. And so I have to remind myself of that. So if, for example, if you go home and you need to make a will, you need to have a conversation with your spouse, you need to share your passwords with your spouse so your spouse is not struggling if you die, all of these things that sometimes we don't want to have these conversations, it's high time we have these conversations, okay? Because we could die tonight, right? That's the reality. And any time, and I need to reflect about God's bounties upon me, right? I want you to do this exercise, and I'm hoping you as a family will do this exercise. When you get into your car today, tonight, after iftar, let's say you have two people in your car, let's say you have three people in your car, or five. I want you to go around the car and say, Baba, what are five things that you are grateful for to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And each person in that car must mention 5 different things that they are grateful for. Do this exercise. Show God you appreciate what He does for you, and God will shower His bounties even more upon us, inshallah. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi at-tahirin.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها